The future is shaped not just by technological change or demographic change, but also by sociological change. Our world is experiencing the biggest generational change since the birth of the post-war baby boomers. Even in today's workforce, we have the baby boomers, we have Generation X, Generation Y, and Generation Z all mixing together. Therefore, it is absolutely critical to understand the attitudes, values, and expectations of these diverse generations. So, joining me to do just that in today's episode is McCrindle's Managing Director, Sophie Renton. Soph, hello, and welcome back to the podcast.
Hello, Ashley. Always a delight to be here.
When we were kind of putting this episode together, I was like, Sophie must be on this because I know that you have been involved in a lot of the research that we've just put out, helped analyze the results, write the survey around our generations defined, but also you do a lot of advisory and thought leadership and consulting around the intergenerational workforce, which I feel like we've just been asked more and more about over the last couple of years. So knew that you were the right person for the job today. So delighted to have you back as always. But before we delve into the questions and the insights and each generation and what they prefer and what they're looking for in a new job, I wanted to ask Soph, when you were starting out in the workforce, do you remember what you were looking for in a place of employment?
I had to reflect on this question because I was like, oh, I've been in the workforce quite a while. I was like, what was I looking for in my first job? And to be honest, I think I was a bit naive around the workplace environment. I thought more about the role that I was doing, that I wanted to be, to believe in the type of work that I was doing. And it was probably more just around like that the workplace had a good vibe. I wouldn't have articulated that as workplace culture, or that there was an investment in training development, or that I, you know, was exposed to great leaders. Like, that just would not have been in my language. It was like, do I love what I do, and do I like the people that I do it with? I was very lucky that my first workplace had an incredible culture, and it probably meant that when I shifted into my next season, that was a little bit higher on the priority list of things to consider and articulate and think about. But still probably at the top is that I was passionate and believed in what I was doing. I do have to say, before in that lovely intro, you were very kind, but you forgot to mention that you wrote the Generations Defined report. So you are also well equipped and an expert in this intergenerational space. You authored Gen Alpha, you authored Workplace Wellbeing. So very kind, but I'm going to give the kudos back to you and also ask you, what were you looking for in your first job? Was it even on your radar?
Yeah, I think for me, and thank you very much, it was great to be able to craft the survey with you, and then you jetted off on your European adventure and I got to work on this report. So it was really interesting. And I guess for me, I'm trying to think back, it was a long time ago now, gosh, but I think I was looking for my first job, something and a place where I could learn. And like you said, I think that the vibe and the culture, like you said, when you're like 18 or 19, whatever it was, like you don't use the words workplace culture. But I think, yeah, recommendations from people, kind of trying to get the vibe from the person interviewing you. You're like, hey, what do they value? Am I going to be treated well? Are they nice? Because when you start out, I feel like at one point you're like, I'm just lucky to be getting a job, because sometimes depends on what the job market's like when you were starting out. Not many people have the choice of just picking and choosing, but you kind of go, okay, trying to just discern the vibe. Are they going to be nice? Are they going to be kind? Because when you're starting out, you make a lot of mistakes. There's a lot of that learning process. So I feel like for me, it was kind of trying to do that. But also I think the job itself and the job description, and was I going to like that? Having said that though, when I started, and I think I've shared this on the podcast before, my first like real job was when I worked at Virgin Active. And I knew the organization was going to be like pretty fun. The brand was very like lively and that sort of thing. And it was a part-time role. But for me, I didn't want to be necessarily like a lifeguard, but that was the job that I got because they had filled all the receptionist roles. And so I ended up being like a lifeguard / a change room assistant. You had to like clean the bathrooms. And I was like, okay, the job itself isn't exactly what I want to be doing. But I was like, but the organization's really cool and it's big and I might be able to move around. So I feel like that was an interesting reflection. Just I think about my first job, you kind of like, you just take what you can get and you exercise a fair bit of humility when you're doing that, when you're starting out. So good memes. But it's fascinating because in this particular study, we asked this question and I feel like just this one question has yielded so much insight about each generation, and we're going to unpack that today. So I thought we could start, Soph, with our youngest cohort of employees, which is the Gen Zs. And if you could share with our listeners how this generation's preferences and priorities differ from other generations when it comes to their career choices, and really, I guess, to explore and talk about why they value growth and learning opportunities so much.
I think to preface I'll just preface that all of these things that we're going to talk about today are actually important to all the generations. It's not like Gen Z cares about this and baby boomers don't at all, but it's more that at different seasons of life, some are amplified more than others. And I think it's about recognizing the season of your team and leaning into that to lead them well. But to do that, you actually need to get to know your team, know what they care about, know where they're at, and know what their goals are of where they're going. So just as, I guess, a scene setter for our conversation today, because you might hear us talk about the fact that, you know, Gen Z really prioritizes growth and learning opportunities. And you're like, well, I'm a Gen X and I still value growth and learning opportunities. It's not that we don't at different ages. It's just as amplified at different seasons. So I think for Gen Z, valuing growth and learning opportunities, a part of that is to do with the age and the stage of life that they're in, that when you're first starting out in your career, you've got an opportunity to be exposed to so many different elements of the workplace. It's an opportunity to grow your skill set, grow your toolbox as it is of what you can lean into and draw out of it. Different roles that you step into. And it's that kind of breadth of experience and growth across multiple areas to test out what you enjoy is a great opportunity that sets you up with a great foundation for your future careers and future roles. And I think as leaders, we need to recognize that when people are starting out in a job and in our workplaces, going, okay, how do I expose them? How do I give them a lot of opportunities to learn so that they can also help them identify what they really enjoy? Because when they first start out, that's very much like a theoretical, I enjoy this. You know, so many people, we've gone to uni and we're like, oh, I love this. And you start studying it and you're like, oh, I really don't. and so like giving people that opportunity to be exposed and then training, because people want to do a good job. And if we just give them, you know, all empowerment but no development, it leaves people out at sea. And so how do we train them and empower them to the same degree to set them up to thrive? That's kind of what I think Gen Z are really looking for when they're first starting out in the workplace.
Yeah, and I think you prefaced that with a really important point, because what we're drawing on for this episode of the podcast today is this research survey question that we asked about what are you most looking for in when you start out in your new job. And we had all these options listed, and it was really interesting because when we segmented those options and the results by each generation, every generation had a different ordering and a different number one kind of what they're most looking for. And for Gen Z, number one was accessible and approachable leadership. Number two, learning and development opportunities. And number three, career progression opportunities. So that's why that learning and development career progression makes sense. And that's why we're talking about that with regards to this generation. And I think there are really great insights there from you, Soph. And one other thing that I've been reflecting on, especially in light of hybrid and the work from home era that we're now in, is that Gen Z, I guess, all of us miss out on so many things when we are fully remote or when we were fully remote during those seasons of lockdowns. But Gen Z, I think, actually miss out on something that probably most generations, when you're starting out in a workplace, you probably don't even realize that's taking place. And that's like kind of the just unintentional learning and just observing people talk on the phone and hearing how people do meetings and how they conduct themselves in the office or how they deal with an unexpected client conversation or a disgruntled client, like whatever it might be, just all those things where you're not like, I'm sitting down with a pen and paper in a PD session or an offsite learning thing and I'm here to learn. Like you're learning so much in those first few years of a new job. And I feel like when we're remote, we kind of miss out on that, especially Gen Z when they're kind of early on in their careers. And so it makes even sense to me that some of the other research we've seen, it's the Gen Zs who are like, we actually want to come back to the workplace. Like we want the connection and the culture and the vibe and to learn and to progress your career. And you do that so often just without even realizing when you're around people that you respect or admire. So fascinating, I guess, insights to see from this particular research that that learning and development is really the number one. And as I mentioned, it differed quite a lot across the generations. And for Gen Y, who are mostly in their 30s and 40s at the moment, they're in those family forming years, they're a bit more established, they're not probably in their first job anymore. I mean, if they are, that's all good. But like most of them.
You're still doing a great job, Ash.
But I think for a lot of people, and a lot of Gen Y, they've had a bit of tenure, they've had a bit of experience. And number one for them was flexible working conditions, which was quite interesting, followed by convenient location and then accessible and approachable leadership. So if, do you feel like that was an accurate depiction and what you were probably expecting? Because when we both belong to this generation as well.
Yeah, I think it is. With Gen Y, we've got to recognise that they're at the family forming years of their life, and it's the family forming years typically where their children are very young. So time is precious. Time is precious to every single generation, but there's that unique season and moment of life where your kids are preschool. You've got that time and the opportunity. And so they want to be there and they want to be present. And I think we've seen that as a social expectation over the last few years that it's both parents being present as well and creating space for that. And for Gen Y, you know, they've done a few years, they've established themselves in the workforce, and in some ways there's an expectation of high trust with leadership that go, you know, I'm not a newbie starting out, like I've earned my stripes, like have some trust that I'm still going to get the job done, I'm going to meet those outcomes, but I really, my job isn't the only thing in my life and I want to prioritize the other things, like, you know, turning up to little Johnny's running race, being present, like those moments, they if you don't prioritize them, they disappear and showing up is important. So they're looking to leadership to be able to have that flexibility to be present in the moments that matter. And I think it's important that we create space for employees to do that. I think as leaderships, you know, it is a tension to be managed because it does create nuance across the organization. It does create an element of, is this fair, or how do we lean into this? And I would just say it's important to have a conversation with the employee about what flexibility means so that everyone's on the same page. Is that flexibility on time? Is that on location? Is it on both? So, like get it all out in the open so you know where you're at. And it was actually interesting. I read a Gallup study the other day. We love their data on the workforce. I think it's really nice when it also validates the stuff that we've done, and we're like, oh great, we're on the same page, despite you know, researching different people, the insights are fairly consistent. But they did a study on leadership, what they thought their people wanted with flexibility, and then the people's expectations on flexibility, and did they actually want flexible work, or I think they called it integrated work, so just that flex of time, or did they want to just work 9 to 5 on the boundaries? And what it actually came out in is that managers overestimated how much time people wanted flexibly, and so more people were wanting this kind of 9 to 5. And I was reflecting on that because I'm like, oh, so much data is about, you know, this desire for flexibility, this desire to you know, be present at different moments. And I guess what I was reflecting on is that there is an element maybe in Gen Y is that they want to have flexibility, they want to integrate their life into work, but they still want to have hard boundaries at the end, and they kind of want it to be on their terms, which I think can be a challenge because for leadership, there is a sense that goes, okay, well, I can provide flexibility, but then these are still the things that we need on the other side. And I think it can't be on one or other's terms. I think you've got to have those conversations to bring it to light and to make sure expectations are clear based on understanding.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's a really great way to flesh out that flexible working perspective because there are, like you said, different generations with different expectations. There's just different individuals with different expectations. Then we've got what we assume people want in our organizations, but then you actually ask them and you have conversations and you might learn different things to different people. So it's definitely, I think, a really good reminder to have those conversations, but to also just be aware more broadly about different generations, different life stages and different priorities. And as we move up or through the generations, we've got the next generation to talk about, which is Gen X, a favourite of yours, I know, to give some limelight to, some well-deserved spotlight on them, because they sometimes get a little bit overlooked. So we're talking about Gen X, and just in case people aren't talking about generations in everyday language like we do, Gen X this year are aged between 44 and 58. So guess in those kind of mid career life stage, they've kind of, again, they've probably got a fair bit of tenure under their belt, and their number one priority when they are looking for a new job is remuneration. So we're probably getting into that kind of mindset where they're maybe negotiating and salary, and they've got probably young kids or teenagers or mortgages, and maybe even some of them have got grandkids, and so they've got a lot of demands on them as well. And the other aspect that we know for them, which came in at number two, was accessible and approachable leadership. And I think it should be said that in the top kind of three for every generation, accessible and approachable leadership came in. So it's really quite a thread that runs through them all. But Gen X looking for remuneration and leadership that they can get on with. What do you feel like that tells us about this particular generation?
You alluded to it before that Gen X, even more so than Gen Y, have built up their career over many years. For many, they're stepping into those leadership roles. And I would say with this remuneration, what they're looking for is this recognition of, I am great at my job and I've earned this, and like, reward me for this experience that I've brought, that I've, you know, maybe I'm stepping into a new role, but I've still got a wealth of life experience, of the workforce, of understanding, of social capital, of engagement that I can still bring with me. So recognize maybe not even just the skills for the job, but the broader things that I bring to the workplace as well. So they're really looking for that recognition. And I think that accessible and approachable leadership almost becomes more of a peer level, that they're a trusted coworker, that, you know, they're not a newbie. They get what's going on. They get how a business runs. They've been exposed to it for a while. So like, allow them into that decision making as much as is appropriate within their organization. But when they're respected, valued, remunerated well, and treated like that trusted coworker, it can really go a long way to contributing to their job satisfaction.
Yeah, I think that's a really great insight. And just another reminder that we're talking about when people look for a new job. And so if you're someone in that life stage, in that generation, if you're making a career change, like you said, you're coming with a lot more experience, and you might be new to the organization, but you're definitely not new to the workforce. And so treating them with that respect is really important. And then at our oldest end of our working generations, we have the baby boomers, who are in, I guess, or starting to probably transition into that later phase of their working life. And they're bringing a shift in priorities as well. So we know that convenience, location, and remuneration are important to them. So any reflections on that, and how you feel like organizations can, I guess, adapt to accommodate for this generation, who might be, yeah, still a very important generation, and even more than the Gen X is bringing a lot of wealth of experience to a new job. But anything we need to keep in mind when we think about the baby boomers and what they're looking for in their work?
Yeah, baby boomers are starting, as you said, to shift into those latter career stages of their life. You know, with the average life expectancy, they still have a long way to go and a lot of rich life left to live. So it's not like they're just expiring or anything like that. But it's at that point that different priorities, I guess, resurface again. And as you say, grandchildren appear on the scene, and similar to the Gen Y, who are in that time where there's only so long that they're not at school for. There's only so many of those years that they can maximize and invest into, that the flexibility and the convenience and the location, so that they've got time to spend it on what they care about, I think heightens in importance. You do start to shift into that legacy mindset a little bit, or prioritizing the here and now, and just being like, you know what, I'm just going to be present, because this is time and I never get it back. So how am I going to use it well? Some of the ways that organizations, I guess, are leaning into this, I think are really interesting, are like grandparents' leave. So it's like a parental leave, but when a new grandchild comes on the scene, great. Like, have capacity to take time off so that you can be present, so that you can be there for that really special time. Or in that, you know, when people are shifting from part-time or downshifting in their role, that can also be a good alternative to scale back over time. It doesn't have to just be you're here or you're not here, but how do we scale back? Because I'm a massive advocate of intergenerational teams and of intergenerational mentoring that, my goodness, our baby boomers have so much life that they've lived. They've got so much expertise. You know, as a very broad generalization, maybe they're not as tech savvy, but there's so many other elements and learnings that they can contribute to the next generation. And how do we, as a team, honor that? And keeping, as a leadership team, keeping older people engaged in the workforce is important because it gives that opportunity for intergenerational mentoring to others coming up. For younger people, I always say, find someone older to learn from. Don't have to make all the mistakes yourself. Like, stand on the shoulders of somebody else and engage. And then that creates community. You know, loneliness is an epidemic in our society. So how do we, you know, build those intergenerational communities in a better way? From an economic perspective, it works to keep people in the workforce. And then even just meaningful work and that sense of contribution is so important to healthy life. So there's so many reasons why we want to keep our baby boomers in the workforce. But I do think it does need to be a recognition of priorities are shifting and how do we work with that to make it a win-win, because there's so many opportunities to make it a win-win.
Absolutely. And I think you so eloquently there answered that question, but you also gave a bit of an insight into the next question, I think. Well, I took away something anyway, just in terms of the application of all of this, where we talk about, I guess, we've explored from the research and the life stage and the context what is important to each generation as they look to a new job or look to engage in a new workplace. But we definitely want to talk about as well, how do we go about creating intergenerational teams and places where people who have different life experiences and contexts and use different slang can actually work harmoniously together and not have friction or lack of understanding. So if I'd be very keen to hear your thoughts, and I think one of the things I took out from your previous answer was even just mentoring and how important that can be as a really practical way to learn from other generations, to develop a relationship of respect. I think about the movie The Intern, where they're basically kind of mentors for each other, reverse mentoring as well, where you learn from someone older and then someone older learns from someone younger. I know that's a movie and it's very idyllic and life is not always like that. But so if any other, I guess, ways that you feel that employers and colleagues can effectively engage with people who are from or of a different generation to them?
I think the first step is to engage effectively is to actually recognize that there are differences, but also recognize that there are a number of similarities. So there are things that divide us, but there's actually often more that unites us. The purpose of the organization, the desire to be at a workplace where everyone wants to be. Like, I don't think any generation is like, oh, I want to work in a dysfunctional team. Like, that's just not an answer. So everyone wants to work in a highly effective, functional team that's working hard for something that they love. So I think as leadership, it's really around aligning people around the vision and empowering them to work together well. And sometimes that does mean that some of the tactics you might use are intergenerational mentoring to connect people up with each other. I think a character trait that's absolutely essential in healthy teams, and especially healthy intergenerational teams, is humility. And you touched on it earlier that we often think of mentoring as just older to the next kind of tier down to the next tier down by age. But actually, it doesn't need to look like that. There is always something that we can learn from each other. And that takes humility to recognize that I might have been working for 60 years, but you know what? I don't know everything and things have changed. There's a lot that I do know really well that I can pass on, but I can still be a student and learn. And so there's the character side of an individual, and then there is the, I guess, structures that you can put in place to help make that happen that really leans into really healthy intergenerational teams.
Yeah, I think that's such great advice. And something that we also put in the Generations Defined report was a couple of key kind of takeaways at the end was understand what makes people different. And we were, of course, talking about like the obvious application of that is to understand what makes generations different and go, okay, we know that Gen Z wants something different to Gen Y. But then I think you've touched on it as well throughout the podcast today to also understand that like it kind of goes, I'm not trying to contradict myself here, but like we believe in generational insights and analysis, and they're really important to take into leadership or just the workplace and understanding of people, but also what makes people different at an individual level, because everyone's got their own unique context and sometimes they don't fit into the generational stereotypes or the stats. Like one example is like for me, I've just celebrated a decade at McCrindle. That's quite a lot longer than the 2 years and 9 month average of most people kind of in my life stage or my age. So I think you've got generational insights that are really helpful to take into and learn about, take into the workplace. But then if you're a leader, you've got to understand the individuals that you lead as well and what drives them and what's their unique family context and what do they want out of their work. So I think you've mentioned both of those things quite well, Soph. So thank you for that. And the final question I have is just as we think again about leaders who are really tasked with that ability to understand the people that they lead, and those great leaders are always thinking about the people they lead. How do you feel that leaders today can create an inclusive and supportive work environment that caters to quite a diverse range of generations and people with different career aspirations?
Yeah, I think with leadership, don't ever get into it for the remuneration. Get into it because you care about people. Because if you're in it for the position, you're going to get really worn out very quickly because leadership in this day and age, it's not about charisma. It's not about even your ability to do the job. It's about your ability to engage with people, to build trust, to unite people around a shared vision, to invest in them as an individual. And I think even to lead with empathy, like those are all interpersonal skills, because as a leader, it's not actually your job to get things done. It's your job to get other people to get things done and to lead them to achieve the outcome. And so that draws on every single personal interpersonal skill that you have. And so I think, you know, in this study, we also asked the question of what do you look for in a leader? And it was approachable and clear communication. And so I think people want to work with people that they actually like and they trust. So investing in relationship is absolutely essential, because when you've got a good relationship, when things don't go well, you can position yourselves to stand side by side and look at the problem and solve it together. If you have no context of relationship, it's very much you standing on either side of the problem, and the problem separates you rather than you can actually lean in together on the problem. So that sense of actually invest in building relationships with every generation. You'll have people you'll connect with more easily, but don't lean into that. Like actually make an effort for every single person of every generation, build that connection, build the trust, point people towards what we're trying to solve together, and then lead them with an empathy and understanding to achieve the outcome.
Yeah, that's such great advice. And it reminds me as well of an event I was at a couple of weeks ago, I was talking about actually some of this research. I was the keynote, and then after me they had a panel of people who work in HR in some pretty big organizations, and it was really interesting to kind of hear their really practical advice and takeaways in response to all the research and the trends that A, we've talked about in this podcast, and B, what I presented like on the day is very similar. And exactly what you said, one of the panelists said something quite profound. They said, if you're a leader, they said, if you've got to let something go, they'll like let go of the like KPI meetings or the business meetings before you let go of time with your team. And it was quite interesting because I think as a leader, you feel all this pressure oftentimes where you're responsible for business outcomes. And we're not saying they don't matter, because they absolutely matter. But it's that idea that if you're a leader, like you said, it's about getting the best out of the people you lead and getting them and empowering them and inspiring them to do great things. And delegating and inspiring rather than you doing everything. And so that was quite a profound, I think, statement. And again, quite maybe a shift across the generations that we've seen around what leadership is, away from that hierarchical style towards more of that collaborating and empowering other people. So yeah, such great insights, Soph, and so helpful for me, because later this week I'm doing another presentation all about this, and then I'll be on a panel, and I'm like, this is a little bit of homework. And for me, just to kind of tease all this out with you, and I know that you have the privilege and the pleasure of presenting these insights around the place at conferences and through podcasts as well. So thank you so much for your time today, for your legacy of work you've done in this space on behalf of our team, which we get to benefit from as you're our leader here, our fearless leader, but also for those that you lead on the platform at conferences and events. So really appreciate you and your time today, Soph. So thank you.
Thank you, Ash. Absolute delight. And, you know, leadership and culture, my favorite topics to talk about. So call me up anytime.
As the listeners, as faithful listeners of the podcast can tell, I've definitely taken you up on that and will continue to do so. And we've referenced a lot today this Generations Defined report, and we're actually releasing at the moment a few different infographics about each generation. So definitely keep your eyes peeled for that. And you can simply head to McCrindle.com if you want to investigate some of this research that we shared today. But of course, if you'd like to stay up to date with our other insights that we're always gathering and releasing, you can subscribe to the podcast. You can also follow us on social media, and McCrindle.com has everything there for you as well. So as always, thank you again for listening to the Future Report podcast, and bye for now.